didn't think so, but I didn't want to overlook anybody.
No, me neither, we're there on one.
All right, county probation. You heard some of the information from Stephanie this morning concerning the revenue on the probation. This is an issue that both Commissioners Eisenbaker and Evans asked us about. And you are also aware that the chairman indicated that he participated in a meeting with state court judges and the probation director, in which there is some concern on the part of the state court that there is a need for additional staffing of probation. Y'all know that we took those individuals that we hired, took over the probation service from the private firm, and they had a mountain of work that they had to correct and bring into compliance. So considering the work that they had, plus the issues amongst them, I am pleased with the efforts that I've had to make. If you turn to the next page, you will see the breakdown on these revenues and so forth. The page works closely with Alicia and has been a liaison between Judge Edwards, Judge Golden, and Felicia and Profession. So, we see the breakdown on your staff and the number of cases. So, Paige, if you'd like to give them an overview of this.
One of the reasons that you see the increase in the fees is because, as Mr. Pritchard said, whenever we took probation over beginning July 1, 2018, we inherited all of the old cases from the prior company that were not being supervised correctly. So probation has a life shelf. It has to be addressed, or the case has to be told or moved on or put on hold, basically, it's a stay. Within a 12-month period, you can't just put people on probation and then they go to charges and everything just kind of be out there floating around. So there were issues with cases that had to be written off. So there was a lot of loss that very first year from a revenue standpoint, but there was an increase in the work because of how to clean up all of that. So I think that the supervision revenue that we're seeing now will probably continue to increase some, and then it will level off until there's other programs put in place to have a positive impact on the number of people who were entering the court system in Lowndes County to begin with, to your point earlier. One of the biggest challenges they have right now is the number of probation officers. So probation falls under the Department of Community Supervision, and we have to send them, whenever they approve, for the county to have a probation department. And it is audited. We have to send them the parameters for our officers, and one of that is the number of cases that they're supposed to supervise. As you all know, having to see some of these people weekly, you can only take a couple hundred people that you're having to see every single week before it gets too much for one person. So right now, we are about 100 probationers over per officer, so we're probably looking at some positions that we'll bring to you all in the budget. To get those numbers where they need to be, because again, that would be part of our audit. The reason why we've not come forward so far is that we needed to get those old cases off the books to see exactly what the real need was, because of course, the last thing we wanted to do was hire too many people. So I think that that's probably the next biggest step. All officers have been fantastic. I can tell you, with Felicia, I don't know that we could hire a more perfect person to understand probation, to understand the dynamic of the county, creating a new department and taking this on and meeting the needs of the court. It's very hard to hire people with probation experience. There's just not a lot of them, especially for misdemeanor probation. And it is a complicated process that the judges do look at daily and weekly, especially if someone's in jail. There's a lot of laws there that you've got to measure up. So she's having to basically turn these people off the street. And to be able to do that in the short amount of time that she has, and for us to be as successful as the department is, it's really outstanding.
Well, I was going to say the same thing. These numbers are just incredible to me. I mean, I'm just amazed. I would have never assumed that.
Okay.
But my question is, what is the difference between the active offender account and the active case account?
So you can have an offender that has more than one case.
Okay.
Sometimes they have multiple. And sometimes they'll have, so they can be on misdemeanor probation and get out of jail, because probation is a probate sentence. So the judge can let them out of jail on probation. They'll go and commit a felony and then end up back in jail. And then get bonded out there, back out on probation.
Pick up their old probation.
Commit a misdemeanor and violate probation and end up back in jail. And the whole time, they're still working on that first set of charges. And so everything else has to get worked out. But meanwhile, they're still having to go to court because of the felony. Their court dates will start to come up because of their second set of misdemeanor charges.
So their probation officers can be basically monitoring the same person for multiple charges?
Oh, sure. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. That makes sense.
The request we received for staffing from Alicia was one additional probation officer.
I think she needs two.
Well, you apparently haven't spoken with the judges. One judge needs recommends at least
eight more?
Yes. the self-proclaimed senior judge says that they need a minimum of 12 more.
So I'm going to be better when I say this as it relates to the budget, but in working and knowing what we've got to get our numbers down to, one of the things that we learned from Henry County that Alicia has been, she's extremely efficient with personnel. Like, she is on it as far as making sure that they're either in court or they're in the office seeing people. So if we had two additional probation officers and we had one more of those case clerks, part of the challenge is that Judge Edwards and Judge Golden have to run court at the same time because of court availability of courtroom space. And you might have a probation officer that has a probationer that will come up in Judge Golden's court about the time when it's also coming up in Judge Edwards' court. Well, the 10 judges on the bench don't know that all of a sudden we've got a log in, and they expect that officer to be ready with that case the minute that case comes up. So these case clerk positions can be in that courtroom to help get those files ready, to let the judge know that they're coming from across the hall. And then they're also there, probation officers have to write down the sentencing and any other special instructions that the judge may give related to that particular probationer. And all that information has to go into the system right then. So the case clerks can handle some of that administrative work while the probation officers split between those two courtrooms. Or there's some court proceedings that the case clerks could attend without probation officers having to be there, which would give them more time in the office to see probationers. That's part of the challenge that we have right now is their court days are twice a week. And so every single person that you see, you're not that all of them report weekly, but you have a huge influx of people into the office 2 days a week because those are the mandatory court days.
I'll also go back to what was said earlier, is that from what the judges were seeing, it was to them apparently a workload issue, but keeping in mind that in-house probation was having to work through all that backlog of cases, and so we felt like that once those cases all got adjudicated and moved out, then what their appearance of too much workload would actually come back down to where it's realistic to what the numbers we need. So again, our staff, along with Felicia's recommendations, is, I think, at the same time, I think it's adequate, at least for a start, you know, to take a look at and see if it's going. We know that we're trying to accomplish a couple of things here, and I'll bring you down to that last number where it says the revocation hearings, 1,140. Well, the only option that those people has when they have a revocation is to go to your jail.
So some of them are already in jail.
Right.
And they'll, if they violate probation and they get picked up on violation of probation warrant, then they'll go to jail. And then they have to come up for a revocation hearing. Or sometimes they do walk-in revocations, not every court circuit does, but they have to come back before the judge, and the judge has to decide either they make their way to stay on probation, or that's when they get sent back to the jail. And people who are in jail 6 months or longer in county jail, that's really costly. That's when they've been there long enough for you to really have them start taking care of their medical and things like that. Within 6 months, they should either we should have them out on probation, or either they've been sentenced by Superior Court and they should be moved out to prison. So that's one of the numbers that we really look at. But yeah, that revocation, if you all ever want to see a group of people who are just bound and determined to make bad decisions and see really what the strenuous part of those caseloads are for probation, they're revocation hearings. They're open to the
So we're looking, staff says we're looking at two officers and one caseload.
Yes.
Do we currently have any open positions just there, or all the positions?
There are. And since, again, to Felicia's credit, since that department stood up, there's only been one person that had been replaced. And it was someone who was hired, they had former law enforcement experience, and they decided to go back to law enforcement. But through all of the challenges that they have faced getting to where they are, that she's been able to retain, all that staff is super impressive. Yeah, she's fantastic.
But she's doing it really by taking a tremendous amount of that load and that burden and putting it on herself.
One of the issues that we have been dealing with from state court is that workload. And this is the court calendar for Judge Turner. And y'all are aware that Judge Turner was previously the state court judge, but her goal is to fill in for those cases where the two judges have a conflict.
Define conflict. Is that like a conflict of interest, knowing the offender, or is that just that they're taking
the decision? They have to accuse themselves for whatever it is. And I'm being facetious to some degree. Paige, you want to touch on that?
No, sir. I don't want to touch that.
But the point is that Judge Turner is as much a full-time judge as we were told here a while back, really, that not only was she just kind of filling in, but that she had one large case that she was trying to finish up adjudicating, working through that process.
That
was what we were initially told, and that would be done. Well, I still haven't heard whether that one's done, but based on her caseload on what's on her calendar, she's doing as much work as the other two.
So, any other questions on probation?
Well, I guess
removed, you know, through a grant, help us half of that being like other litigation. So we have probation and kind of what's left available space. There are some tenants that might be able to be redistributed, that we give them just a little more. But as our county continues to grow, and at some point we'll have to add more just because our population's gonna grow, and that's gonna increase the number of people in the system, unfortunately. So long term, I know.
And in a previous discussion that we had, or I guess just information that we provided through the SLOSS, there is part of that solution is the county purchasing the old regional commission office that they're gonna be vacating shortly. And then, of course, allowing the health department to take that, and they would have to do, they can get money for renovation and to do work, but they can't get money to purchase a facility. So that potentially could move a public health agency out of that Leila Ellis to this location, which could free up space for future growth.
And we asked Felicia as far as like location goes, if something else down the road, because at one point there was jail, was a, there was, it was their space, could they be moved there, and there's not enough space. But she has said that it's kind of a industry known truth with probation that you don't ever want them outside of walking distance from the courthouse, because that has a lot to do with people getting to court and that accountability and your success numbers, which is why we, for so many years, seen felony probation rent space downtown and try to stay within that close proximity. I think, too, along with this, the courtroom space is a challenge.
Well, we're going to have to do something with the courtroom space in the jail. And we have the issue that the most logical space available right now for the expansion of probation is the Homeless Coalition. If you all recall, the Homeless Coalition was forgiven a debt of $20,400 that they owed. They now owe $20,709. I see no reasonable expectation for you to see that in your emails. But you're going to have to expand that probation. Homeless Coalition to utilize that space, of course, you're not going to have to face your budget.
So I just want to know how many people are really helping or what have you. I'd like to see kind of how effective they
are. Well, it's a little later in here in this discussion. And I go into this simply because of the space comment. And so I'll tell you a little bit more on that.
Yes. Those additional ones, when we definitely more office space, but I was looking at having the probation office versus, you know, the few years, I mean, the act in the case, I mean, that is a lot of people to be responsible for officers. And since I know, you know, we're saying possibly three, and
looking at even this amount here, coming out of supervisory fees, I think it's fair to say that you're going to lose a continuing increase, corresponding to the increase in courts. As those numbers continue to increase, we'll have to see a correlating increase in population.
For those less informed in the room, can you give me like the 30-second version of the Homeless Coalition? And
Homeless Coalition has been in that facility for
since its inception.
And it's been through a couple of different directors. And basically, it's kind of like what was said earlier today. There's a number of these projects, well-meaning, well-intentioned projects, to address a particular issue. Many years ago, when I first got here, Commissioner Evans and I met with groups where they would come to us to be a pass group for the grant. They wanted grant money for homeless women, homeless men, homeless women with children, homeless men with children. All of them requiring separate, having separate needs, all of them requiring funding. The issue was when we said, show us what you are doing to address the problem. How many homeless men, women with children, men with children, are you addressing? It was almost non-existent. When pressured, they could not tell us anything. The main thing was that they received an administrative portion of the funds that they used to pay themselves. Well, Commissioner Evans has been kind of the liaison between the county and the Homeless Coalition for years. And they would say to her, we don't have any money. Well, you got a grant, what do you do with it? Well, we have to pay our people. Well, we don't have any money for anything else. Well, what do you do?
Providing a salary for some body.
And so you,
ALBB.
But the other side of that coin was, we are meeting a need for the people in this community that you as the county have a responsibility for and are not addressing that problem. Is that right?
So basically,
that's
saying,
the reason I put it on my thing to talk about the Homeless Coalition, because within the last 3 or 4 months, I have went to each one of them meetings, and they all talk about the same thing. Again, not the mayor, second one, which is the church about the space deal. They're free because they don't pay the rent.
Right.
So, you know, they never come and talk to us about their plan, what they're doing, and how we can facilitate the service. Let's go back years ago, we was a pass-through for the grants, and this pass-through, and we had to pay the money back. So, you know, it's just one of the things that I mentioned in my talk about the homeless, that it is seven or eight different agencies that are receiving funds. And so in the meeting, I talked with them about coming together, and we sit down and talk about what we can do and how we can pull those coalitions together and get something moving, because the homeless population keeps to me is a problem.
But basically they're saying, if I got this right, hey y'all, let us use y'all for the pass through for grant money. And in exchange, you get to say as an elected official, well, we're doing something about homeless.
That's
and we really know that nothing's getting done.
But the grants are still coming through Knox County. And the problem that they're not really doing what they need to do.
Yeah. So we have a decision to make. Do we, if we're not getting, again, value for the money we're spending, because at the end of the day, it's still taxpayer dollar, whether it comes from the state or the feds or us. We need to stay.
Well, and just to clarify, and that was during one of these changes of the director, they came and said, hey, we have $20,000, we can't pay it, and it's not really fair to the current director. If you forgive it, we'll start paying. And they paid it for about 3 months and
had
it paid
us.
So now
they're at
another
$20,000. But we look bad if we put it off and stop allowing that to happen.
Keep them out. But that's the only option. Because the history shown is that they're not going to pay. I went and spoke to the director myself, specifically was involved with those discussions when we were talking about it. That listen, we know you can't pay this, but we need you to start paying. So, we'll forgive this, you start paying. We're ready to pay. And it didn't happen.
Campus?
Yes. It didn't happen.
employees sitting here.
Oh, wait, what?
And then right next to me, got the late program that you could buy the facility near to me. They can get an office there with the late program.
It was really difficult when, prior to putting probation in there, we had LAMP and homeless coalition, because there was on occasion, I won't say, fights, but there were certain disagreements as to who were going to
get a partner for something.
Fund or support. We'll support, don't go to the city and go, no.
And you'd be surprised with the calls I get on a regular basis about, I'm not doing this, and homeless coalition not doing that, and you go and talk one of the others, so I just decided.
Well, that goes back to my earlier comment, the law folks that are doing potentially good things, but nobody knows what they're doing, and as an end result, I'm not sure that the need is being fulfilled, because it's just so far.
No, you're not, it's very good, hey.
I'm scared of the chief, I mean, the president, so, I think it's about eight of them to sit down and be able to talk for next month.
So I direct your attention to our mission statement that says effective, efficient, effective, and responsive local government, so what do we do next?
I was gonna have this meeting, we're gonna talk with them, and they pull together and do, and not doing anything separately, so we could do something, you know, collective.
Well, if they could, I mean, we keep, kind of getting down into the weeds, but we have to have those discussions, but I think kind of, we should call for it, based on the fact that they applied for grants and got grants for their administrative operations, I'm not sure that you can co-mingle those two projects together then.
We're walking just the next door.
I understand, but I'm just saying what legally they can do and what they can't do.
Let me get us back to probation. Is there any additional questions concerning probation? So if not, we know that this is a short-term goal. It depends on what you talk about as far as future growth, if you talk about just growth in the department, and I think, yes.
Well, that, yeah, that, and as the community grows, there's going to be a bigger need.
I would add that I would really like somebody to make sure Alicia understands how appreciative we are of her success.
You can do that yourself.
Okay, I'm going to tell you a lot of advice, and I'll
call. Okay, so call.
Move support.
I'm going to talk to you all in a minute.
Y'all are aware that we have agreements with Dr. Lucy Green, who provides us with daily and monthly updates on communication between Pentagon, Moody Air Force Base, and Dr. Lucy. She gives us that, the chairman of myself, daily.
Gotcha.
Daily. We also